Afternoon, everybody. Appreciate you being here. Just as Matt said, I'll talk first about the team, the game, most pressing thing right now, and then also a couple comments about yesterday's announcement. First of all, just going back a little bit, coming off a bye week right now, and that's, sometimes a good thing, sometimes a bad thing, but this time of year it really was helpful for us. We were a little bit banged up physically, so it gave us a chance to rest our players that have been playing pretty extensively, give them a mental break also, cut back a lot on what they did, and then also move some of the younger guys forward. So it's always a good opportunity for the team to move forward, and hopefully that's what we got accomplished last week. So certainly we're back into a game day mode or game week mode, and right now our focus is entirely on getting ready for the game in Chicago. Captains this week, we still have three of the same four: Joe Evans, Jay Higgins, Luke Lachey, and then Logan Lee will be our fourth captain now. And then injury-wise, pretty good health, at least it looks like at this point. TJ Hall is still out, but I think fairly realistic to say our Bells have a chance to play and a little bit healthier than they were last time we were on the field. So certainly a good thing. Northwestern, just talk about them for a little bit. Look at least to be a team that's really playing well, playing with confidence, playing with energy. And I think showing improvement week to week. I think their head coach's comments reflected that yesterday with his press conference, and I would verify it. Just having a chance to watch them right now, I think they're really gaining momentum and playing with good confidence, like I said. Got a new quarterback here. Has played the last three games. Seems like he's really was a catalyst for him Saturday, doing a really nice job out there. And basically, two things that really kind of stand out to me. If you look at last week's game against Maryland, they had a 7-point lead. Maryland took the ball down to the 1-yard line, had three shots from the one. And Northwestern got three stops, which is pretty impressive, pretty difficult to do. And then more impressively, Northwestern took the ball and drove it, whatever it was, 77 yards, and got a field goal out of it. So basically went from Maryland had a chance to tie it up, and next thing you know, Northwestern's got a 10-point lead and really took control of the game from that point. So I think that says a lot about them. If you go back to the Minnesota game earlier, the fact that they were down significantly, came back, scored 21 points in that fourth quarter, and then won in the overtime period, just tells you, I think, that a lot of people are doing a lot of things well up there, and their players are responding. So that being said, we just look at this. It's another tough Big Ten road game. Expect it to be competitive, really competitive and really tight. And I'm guessing both teams are looking at that way as we go into it. Kid captain this week is Lincoln Veach, a young guy from Maquoketa. And Lincoln's story is this. He was diagnosed with leukemia at age 4. It was complicated by a life-threatening infection during his treatment time, and spent, I think, like 100 days over in the Stead Family Hospital. So pretty tough road there. 10 surgeries, chemotherapy, still on chemotherapy and advancing, getting better. And he's a kindergartner right now. Amazingly tough young guy. And we'll be thinking about him and his family this week when we travel over to Chicago. So just a couple words about that. Regarding the announcement yesterday, just briefly address some, the announcement that came out of the AD's office, and I suspect you'll probably have questions, so we'll take a few of those afterwards. And just basically say this, okay, for 25 years, tried to operate with a singular focus of doing what I feel is best for the program, and that's mainly the players and everybody that works in this building. That's my first obligation. And basically, my philosophy, my practice, I think, has been pretty consistent. Typically, we go through the season and then run an evaluation of the program top to bottom afterwards. And, yesterday's announcement, certainly a departure from that practice, but that's really what we've tried to do for the past 24 years. Final analysis, would say this. I'm really proud of our players, proud of our coaches. I think they've done a good job over the long time. And what we do now is move forward, and our focus is on getting ready for this ball game. And then, bigger picture, all four games. But, decisions are made on Saturdays are based, player-wise, based on us watching the guys during the out-of-season, in-season. A lot of hours of evaluation time we spend with them just in classrooms, all those types of things. And, just really, really proud of our players. I think they've done a great job. Our staff's done a great job. We've had challenges that sometimes you can't foresee, and this season's one of those. But you play through it, you work through it, and that's our plan moving forward. Again, just very, very proud of the program, the success that we've had. And this is just one of those things we'll have to work through as well. So, as you know, I did request to be the public voice this week. I thought it was best to protect our players a little bit, pull them out of the interview list. You'll get a chance to talk to them Saturday, certainly, and beyond that. But, you know, I think in light of what's going on right now, I think it's best for us just to stay tight and keep our focus on the game at hand, because that is the most important thing, and that's what we owe to our 120-plus players. So that's really where our focus has been. And, you know, our plan is to move forward here and do our best to finish out this portion of the season strong. It's an 8-week season, 4-week season. And we have an opportunity to do some really good things right now, and I think we're all excited about that. Historically, I think this program's had 10 win seasons in 100 and whatever years, 1889. We got an opportunity for that and potentially beyond that too, which would be historic. So, but it's like any game. Our focus is on doing what we can do this week. That's the only one that counts. What we can do this week to be successful, and that's where our focus is. So, again, I just ask you to appreciate that. And, you know, there'd be plenty of other time for discussion as well, you know, after the season if we want to go back and go through all the detail and minutia, all that stuff. But I'll throw it out for questions.
Scott Docterman with The Athletic. Kirk, just kind of want to know a little bit more about the timeline of events. When were you notified by Beth Goetz regarding either this decision? What were the consultations like? And then the announcement, when you were made aware of it?
I had access to the announcement that you read, we all read, over the weekend. So, yeah, that was the timeline.
Chad Lystico, Des Moines Register. In light of things that have transpired, are you definitively returning yourself next season, or is that still up in the air?
My plans are like they always are, to worry about this game and bigger scale, bigger picture of these four games. And that's where my focus has been this entire season. Obviously, it was more than four games a week ago or 2 weeks ago. That's what I think about. And that's each and every year. It's been pretty consistent, just like the other things I referenced.
David Eichel, 24/7 Sports. Kirk, I mean, again, given the timing and this stepping away from your typical practice, Beth's still on an interim scale. I mean, is this going to impact your relationship going forward with Beth, and just how do you kind of balance out what the decision that's made, but also moving forward?
Yeah, the only forward I'm thinking about right now is now till Saturday, and that it's been that way each and every week of my career, quite frankly, and that's how you operate when you're in season. You know, there's a chain of command in everything we do. Coach John Hayden Fry would frequently remind us, some of the younger guys, I think he was referring to myself, and Dan McCarney, could have used some time in the military to learn the chain of command, and you'd throw the insubordination term around, but hopefully I've never was guilty of that with him or anybody else. So, you know, there's a chain of command to everything, and I respect that, and, you know, we move forward.
Tom Kakert, Hawkeye Report. Kirk, listening to your statement, it sounded like, is your frustration with the timing that it happened before the end of the season, or with the decision itself, or both?
No, I can just say that, you know, my policy has typically been to evaluate everything, players, coaches, all that, postseason, because in season we've got a lot on our plates. And, you know, that's just kind of been the nature of it. And it's been that way probably since I got started full-time in 81. You know, there's just not enough time in the day. So that's where our focus is. Everything you do is precious in terms of time relations. And, so to me, it's a better time. It's a less emotional time. It's, you know, I can give you a lot of reasons why I've done it that way. But, you know, it really doesn't matter. It's really not significant right now because we are dealing with something that we have to deal with, and we will. And that's one of the points I always make to our team in camp, at the end of camp. There are a lot of factors, usually boiled down to about three or four of them, but one that never changes is how do you handle the bumps that you don't anticipate, the things that maybe you can't see coming, certainly don't see coming in August, early September. So it's part of any season, just like injuries. I mean, those are parts of seasons, and then how you respond to those things, that's how you get defined. And so, you know, this is just, it's one more of those things that you have to try to compartmentalize and put it in the right position. And then the most important question is, what do we have to do to work forward and, you know, be successful to be successful?
John Steppe, Cedar Rapids Gazette. If you stay past 2023, what will be the timeline?
I could hit by a truck tomorrow. Like, you know, that's a reality. I figured that out a long time ago, too.
So assuming that you're still here 2024, what would be the timeline for finding Brian's replacement, and how much latitude would the next offensive coordinator have to make changes?
Okay, so that's kind of go back here. Really what I'm really worried about right now are the next 4 weeks, and I think anything beyond that's getting way ahead. That would be an injustice to our football team to be thinking about any of those things that you mentioned. And that's my first loyalty is to the football team. So, you know, things are in your control, which I think this is. You know, it's just you do what you can do that's going to give us our best chance to be successful, knowing that all four of these games are going to be really challenging. You know, that's not going to change. So I'd really be foolish to be giving too much thought to things that are outside of the realm of that.
Adam Jacoby, Go Iowa Awesome. Now that you can step back and look, is there anything that you sort of regret about the plan that Brian was put on, the 25 points per game and all of those goals?
You know, I respect that, and I'm really not good at that, you know, looking back picture of that game, because it really doesn't serve much purpose, you know. I think when all that took place, you know, Brian's the one who signed it, and I think, you know, he thought it was the best option available, and I would have co-signed that. Not that that was my business, but so it was. And so I said earlier, there's been a lot of really unusual things this year that I think have affected our play. If you want to look back at recent history, look at 2009. I think you could figure that one out. The course of our season changed very dramatically. I'll go back. I'll one up you 1984. And just coincidentally, it was the first weekend of November. We had a couple bumps there. We were sitting direct path to the Rose Bowl. Had a couple injuries, and things changed really fast. So that happens in football. You just got to deal with it. And, you know, you can't worry about the 8 million things that might happen here in the next 2 weeks. Now you're talking about a waste of time. That's a waste of time, too.
Scott Docterman, The Athletic. I wanted to ask you about this on a personal level. Mm-hmm. I mean, how does this affect you in that regard? Because obviously you and Brian have a different relationship.
Yeah, yes and no. I mean, obviously we have a biological relationship, and I'm very fond of him. But I've had a lot of strong relationships with a lot of people that worked here, and that's one of the beauties of what we do. So if this were anybody on our staff that fell into this category, I'd feel bad about it. But I'm guessing they would encourage us to keep moving forward, too, and that's, you know, it's just what you have to do.
Hi, Kirk. Shannon Earhart, KCCI. What were your emotions like when you found out?
Well, again, that really is not pertinent to the topic either. And it just kind of follow up what Scott just asked. You know, we're all not best friends. It's like a team. You got 120 guys, not everybody's best friends, but we all have a lot of mutual respect for each other. All share common goals. That's one of the beauties of this sport. And one of the beauties of the sport are the far-reaching numbers. We have 120-plus team guys on our football team. So, you know, to get guys to become close, to develop a chemistry, all those things, that's the beauty of the game. And my 34 years here, we've had tremendous stability. Unusual. I don't want to call it rare. But, yeah, it probably is rare. It's probably a fair word. I haven't done a study on it. But we've had pretty good stability overall for – yeah, my 34 years here. So that's one of the, you know, that's one of the real perks of it all. And, you know, anytime anybody goes through a setback, it's, you know, you always feel bad. You know, it's just like losing a game. You feel bad about that, too. But you move on. Yeah. And then we'll shift gears here to the game here at some point. I'm a lot more focused on that. Yeah.
Kirk, John Sears, WHO-TV. Looking back in this past year with you and your son, anything you would have done differently, maybe to change the way things have panned out?
Well, yeah. I mean, kept everybody healthy. But, you know, again, you can't play that game. You just can't play that game. It is what it is. We're at where we're at, and we're moving forward. That's all you can do.
Chad Lysico, Des Moines Register. How much thought, if any, was given to quarterback switch during the bye week? Is Deacon still your guy? Is Joe Labus still your number two guy going into this game?
Yeah, I mean, we've looked at every position, let everybody compete and let everybody practice. And again, the older guys, the guys that are more experienced, Didn't get a lot of work. They got some work last week, but not to the extent of a normal, normal practice week, I would say. But yeah, as we sit right now at the quarterback position, it's a clear 1-2-3, and we'll keep an open mind as we move forward. I'm sorry. Right. Yep.
Hi, Kirk. Jack Leader with KCRG in Cedar Rapids. With regard to the next four games, do you see any change in the play calling at all, considering the circumstances of, for lack of a better term, a lame duck offensive coordinator?
Yeah, I mean, really, it's more based on who the players are and what they can do. And that is changing. It's changed dramatically already this year. So you try to bend and yield, move in a direction where the players that are going to be playing, the guys that are in the game, can do some things. That's a possibility. Depends who's in the game, but we'll do what we think is best. You know, the first and foremost thing, if you want to start with something that's really important, start with better ball security. That would be a major thing, and it's really hard to win football games at this level. Thinking you can turn it over three times and your opponent doesn't, that's pretty much a foregone conclusion how the game's going to go. So, yeah, there's a lot of things we need to do better right now, but if we're going to excel, and Stansy's the only guy that can break this rule, we got to take care of the football. We got to take care of that, and then we'll go from there. And we do have some strengths on our team right now, so you try to play to your strengths as well, and that's 25 years worth of that too.
Coach Blake Hornstein, Hawkeye headquarters. Yep. Any thoughts on playing at Wrigley Field? Are you a baseball fan of any chance? And any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I guess. And my first response, I think, is baseball is for baseball. I love baseball. And I'm a little, not upset, but disappointed. I really haven't gotten to see much this year. Not that we get to see much ever, because we're usually working. But, so I've only had one experience, I think, playing in a baseball stadium, and that was unique. First-class treatment, but the field was not great. And there's some challenges with this. This would be the first time in my career. I remember watching, I'm old enough to watch Bud Grant and the Vikings in the old Metropolitan Stadium. It was probably black and white TV, but they were both on the same sideline. It was about 12 degrees. But playing on the same sideline is really a unique challenge. Baseball locker room, single file, up and down steps, all things like that. When you got 70 guys you're trying to get through there, it's going to be some challenges, signal stealing. Subbing from one end of the field to the other. There's a lot. I teased, we had a little conference call yesterday. I teased Ron Snodgrass, who's the official, who's an outstanding official and a really good person. I thought he must have just, really pissed somebody off to get this being, because trying to manage the clock in this situation is going to be a real challenge. It's interesting, but it's like anything else. We're going to make it go. Be a thrill.
Hey, Kirk. Elliot Clough, iowa.rivals.com. Looking ahead with this game this weekend, the next 4 weeks, how do you keep the current circumstances from being a distraction?
You move on. You just move on. You block it out. It's like anything else that could be a distraction. If you let it be one, it will be. But we're all adults, and Warren Parker used to say it all the time, boys do what they want to do and men do what they have to do. I don't mean that in a sexist way. Adults do what they have to do. And we work with a young population, so there's some relevance to that. And that's one of the challenges, is learning how to focus on what you have to focus on. Because I can just tell you this, as competitive as this conference is, if we allow that to be a distraction, just like injuries, then chances are we minimize our chances for success. And it's tough already. It's a tough conference to win in. I can tell you that from experience. So every little thing that you might give up is significant. And just, why would you do that? Why would you surrender that? So that's in our power, and that's in our control if we let it be that way.
Tom Kakert, Hawkeye Report. Kirk, you mentioned sign stealing. How prevalent is that in the Big Ten? And did you guys played Michigan? Did you feel that was going on?
Yeah, no, I don't worry. I just, I've never really put much stock in that. I'm sure it goes on. It does in baseball, I know. And there are things that we can do, and I think are being discussed, to better serve ourselves, to protect ourselves from ourselves. Coaches have always been competitive. I won't identify the place. It was not here. But one time in my career, I sat in a room and heard about, we knew 95% of the calls on the other team. It just so happens that quarterback that we were playing that day was not a he's not in the record books for performance at that level. But he did set a stadium passing record that day, and like a smart ass, I'm sitting there thinking to myself, I didn't articulate this, but I'm thinking, boy, it's a good thing we knew those calls. It could have been X amount of yards instead of only 400. So my personal feeling is sometimes you get so fixated on that and caught up in that stuff, you forget about playing. And I you know, maybe I'm naive, but that's kind of been the way we've operated for a long time, at least the way I operate. But it's not new. No, it's not new.
Michael Haas, Cedar Rapids Gazette. Kirk, when you and Brian and had the meeting, first of all, I'm sorry I'm reverting back, but I didn't get a chance to ask in the earlier portion of this. When you and Brian and Beth and President Wilson met, what did they tell you about why now as opposed to waiting until season's end?
I don't know what's been disclosed about who met, but what I just heard is not 100% accurate. You know, and again, the details that are private, they're, you know, and who conferred with each other, that's private as well, other than what's been released. But again, it really doesn't matter at this point. You know, the decision's been made. It's the university's position, and, yeah, we're moving forward. We have four games. What I'm looking at, Mike, we're a 6-2 football team right now, which it's not great. It's not perfect, but it's not bad. We do have an opportunity to win 10. And again, just what I said a minute ago, it's going to be extremely difficult. But we have an opportunity. So, you know, I've always tend to look at what's the upside in things. And right now that's our goal, to win those four games that remain, just like I'm sure everybody else on our schedule is trying to do. And then if we get a chance to win 11, we'll try to win 11. If we get a shot at 12, we'll go for that too. And if you go beyond that, that'd be great. But, yeah, that's probably about as good as we can do, which would be okay. That's really all that matters at this point.
Scott Docterman, The Athletic. Wanted to ask you about offense, specifically, you know, negative plays aside. What can you do better positively to put your team in a position to score more points, to move the ball a little bit better than what we've seen last few weeks?
First things first, let's ball security. Let's go right back there, because that really impacted the game pretty significantly last time we were out there. And again, if it's, I think it was 3-0, wasn't it? I don't think they gave one up. So if you're down 3-0, you know, it's going to be tough. It's tough to outscore people getting those kinds of games. You're going to be sloppy with the football. But yeah, I mean, those are things we've been working on, believe it or not, since August. And I thought we were on the right path. We've had some things altered this season. And so we've got to work through those. There's no magic panacea. Avoiding negative yardage plays, to your point, would be a real starting point. To get ahead in the chains would be a real starting, you know, benefit as well. So little things like that, and then at some place along the way, you got to make some big plays. And that's just how offense works typically. Is so starts with minimizing your mistakes, ball security being the first and foremost one. Secondly, not having negative yardage plays. Like, I'm not a good stat guy, but you know, if you take a sack or get negative yardage, get thrown off, the chances not only of getting a first down, but more importantly, scoring are really minimized in the NFL. It's a dramatic number. If you get a sack, you might as well throw it out the window and go for the, you might as well punt it and try to get the ball back. So not that you would, but you understand the point. And then, you know, at some point, good football teams find ways to make plays. But you can design one every now and then, but it's usually just somebody making a really good play and then doing a little something extra.
Chad Lystico, Des Moines Register again. There's a metric out there that Deacon Hill is 160th out of 160 in turnover-worthy plays. That's, you know, interceptions, you know, fumbles, balls tipped, all that stuff. So how do you equate that, you know, him still being QB1 with such a high turnover possibility when he's in the game? And I mean, or are the other guys just that bad?
Well, yeah, those are your words, not mine, certainly. I wouldn't say our guys are that bad. I mean, they're playing major college football, but yeah, we go through, we've been evaluating since the start of spring practice, and, you know, you look at the body of work, you know, we, believe it or not, we, at least I think we know a little bit more about our guys because we see a lot more. Our judgment's 100% correct, you know, rarely, when you talk about player evaluation, that type of thing, but all you can do is try to make the best decisions based on what the evidence is and what you see on a daily basis, and then move forward. By you saying somebody else might be bad is suggesting the other guy's bad too. So I don't look at it that way. We're looking with trying to grow guys that haven't played very much and see how well they can move forward here and how quickly they can move forward. But I'll go back to the first point and to your point. You know, if we're going to beat ourselves, it's going to be tough to win. And, you know, so far we've lost two games this year, so have had experience with losing. 25 years, got plenty of experience with losing. I'm an expert at getting my ass kicked. But that's one thing I am an expert in. But you get back on your feet and you move forward.
Tyler Tashman with the Des Moines Register. This is kind of a coming from a different aspect of things, but Torrey has obviously gotten a lot of attention for what he's done. But Drew Stevens has also been really valuable. How did you just originally kind of find him? How did he get on your radar?
Well, talking about Drew or Torrey? Yeah. I believe the origin, you know, Duncan's from out there. Keith Duncan grew up in that area. So the kicking guys have a network. There's an Australian one. There's a place kicker one. They all have like a little network and all that kind of stuff. So that was a connection there. I remember distinctly meeting with he and his dad out here, thinking, you know, boy, am I wasting my time today? Just shaking hands and visiting a little bit. Let me get this straight. He's from South Carolina. He's going to come to Iowa as a walk-on. Okay, why would that make sense? And he looked like he was 12 at that time. So little did I know that, you know, however many years, 3-4 years later, this is what it looked like. But he's done a great job. He really has done a great job. And I've said this before publicly. Nobody had a worse spring. He came early, left high school early, and he was just, you know, got awful out there. I remember his dad, pretty sure it was Easter. It was Easter Day. I remember pulling in here, getting out of my car, and some guy jumps out of a car over there. And I'm thinking, like, this guy's a stalker or what, you know, what it is. It was his dad trying to get in. Because Drew was having a rough time. He had flown up that morning and wanted to have dinner with him and just spent some time one-on-one. So I let him in the building and took him. Drew was in kicking, actually in the indoor. And, you know, those are the stories behind, things you guys don't get access to. But anybody that's usually successful has somebody supporting them in a healthy way, hopefully in the right way. It's like most good players, the hard work is done by the individual, and that's what Drew's done. He's changed his body physically. He's obviously matured. And again, he was like 15 when he got here. He's a young guy, early graduate. But he's just done a lot of good things. And then I'll transition it. I was teasing Torrey this morning out there. It was a little brisk and a little windy. And, you know, he was booming the ball. And I said, you know, 4 years ago, there's no way you could have done this. And he just joked. He said, I never punted at American football until 4 years ago. So Torrey's an outstanding player, just an outstanding player, having a great season. But he's worked extremely hard for it, and that's usually the story behind the story. And I'll go back to the quarterbacks. You know, none of them are really experienced right now. So we're going to have to, like, you know, there's no free agents we can go out and grab right now. Fitzpatrick's, I think, done. I think I saw him on TV, right? That would have added to his repertoire of teams. But, that's not available. So we got to work with the guys we have and try to get them better. And it's that way at every position, each and every position. One thing I can assure you, I can't think of a lot of guys that are out there playing that really don't care. Like, these guys care. They care about each other. They work hard. They work hard. Are they perfect all the time? No. Do they live up to everybody's expectations? No. It's not realistic. But, you know, these guys work hard. And they all got stories just like the ones I mentioned there.
Three more questions. Adam Jacoby, Go Iowa Awesome. You mentioned that Deacon Hill's a younger quarterback. Obviously got pressed into action. Do you think that he is in position to succeed with everything that's around him, or are these struggles to be expected?
Famous words. We'll see. All right. Not to kill the talk season, but, you know, the off season, everybody's speculating. All right. Nobody's talking about the Jets right now in the Super Bowl. They were all summer. All right. But we'll see. I mean, we don't know. I don't know the answers. I think he's got a lot of really good qualities. And go back to his history, playing on a Wildcat team. He and I were talking about it yesterday. His buddy was in here from Valparaiso, who's a receiver. And he played and lived in Deacon's house for whatever, like 4 or 6 weeks. I don't know. Somehow must have beat the COVID. They didn't arrest him for being a COVID violator in California. But he lived in Deacon's house, played on that Wildcat team that they had during COVID because nobody was really playing COVID-sanctioned football back then. So his senior year was disrupted. Obviously, he hasn't played at his last school. And this is all new for him. And I'm not going to ask people to have patience, but I think it's realistic to think that, you know, it may take him some time to get going. But we as coaches have seen plenty to be encouraged about and plenty that we feel good about. And I think if he's persistent, if he keeps working hard, some better days are ahead for him. And he's already done some good things. So we're going to try to build off of that just like we would every other player on our team.
What stands out to you about Sebastian Castro?
His growth, you know, just talking about guys who have grown. And a guy, Sebastian, who probably wasn't ready for primetime 2 years ago, played special teams, like some of the guys on our special teams right now will end up being really good players. But again, the common denominator, he's done the hard work. He's paid his dues. He's been out there every day. He's a tough-minded guy. He loves the sport, loves his teammates. And probably his biggest challenge right now, besides trying to, you know, keep their quarterback contained, second biggest challenge would be getting his ticket order filled because, you know, he and LaShawn are going back home. And it's never fun going home because everybody in the world wants a ticket. And they're all your best friend 4 years ago. So but I think he's got it under control.
Where would you evaluate the offensive line at this point with these last four games to go? And how much of a part has Rusty Feth played in that group's development this year?
Yeah, I'll fall back. I think they're improving. I'll fall back. You know, we do our full evaluations after the year. Rusty's been a great addition. And, you know, you hear all the negatives about NIL, and there's plenty of them. But, you know, I look at some of the guys that have just come in here and done a great job, and he's really been a good stabilizer. He's a veteran guy. And, you know, this is talking about the quarterback thing. You can't – during the season, you can't get that. I think he's just a mature kid that loves football. He's meshed extremely well and extremely quickly with his teammates. I'd say the same thing about Nick Jackson, two guys that got here in June. And that was a little concern. Okay, you know, rather have him here in the spring, but they got here in June. And so it's proof if you get the right guys, Heflin, Makai Sargent, thinking about guys in the past that have done well and done well that next year they showed up that got here late also. So, yeah, nothing's impossible. There's always value out there if you find the right people. Yeah, but he's done a really nice job. Okay, thank you.
Thanks.